Heavenly Father, again, Lord, we ask you this morning to be with us, help us, to and guiding us to the right path, and believe more and more in you, and have no doubts that you, the Almighty God, who's in control of everything in this planet Earth. And not only that, Lord, you know how many hair we have on our head, so you count everyone. We not even know that. But you know. So that means that you take care of everything, every business, every concern, every worry that we have in our lives. You're there to help us. Thank you for that, Lord. And thank you for your Holy Spirit who can guide us in this service. To the beginning, to the end. Bless every family and open our minds and heart this morning so we can be receptive to your word. In Jesus we ask. Amen. Well, I can say that we have issues in our lives that make us worry and thinking about so many things that sometimes we don't have the solution. We don't have the solution, and because of that, we have to depend on God. I'm going to ask you maybe many questions, and some questions that the Bible had the answers, but I just want you guys engage with me in this study. By any chance, do you have, during your life, do you have to travel? And you schedule the trip, and then the day is approaching. Do you have that chance? How do you feel when the day is approaching? Because you schedule it, some trips, years, months, weeks in advance. I booking a lot of trips because of my job. So for some people, it's like a normal thing, booking a trip. For some people, they don't travel, and to book a trip, the day is approaching, and you're concerned. What do you need? You're not going to forget things. What exactly you need for that trip? All that kind of stuff. You may preparation for that. Do you have that experience? Okay. That is a trip for pleasure, what I'm describing. But I want to describe another trip. When you return, do you ever have that trip? Do you have a son or daughter who joined the military and you don't know when she or he will come back? As a mother or father, do you have that experience? Anyone in here? When you see that son or daughter depart from you, how do you feel? Happy? No. You sad. You cry. Right? And let me tell you something. It's some trip we make in our life that we don't come back. And that is dead. Anyone is prepared for that? No one. No one is prepared for that. Except if you get cancer. Some doctor in England years ago, he said the most we can say, thank God for cancer. Let me tell you why. And everybody blasted that doctor. He said, the cancer is the only disease. You can plan everything. No other disease, you can die immediately. Heart attack doesn't give you no chance to prepare a will, who you're going to give this, who, or you go to you your neighbor because you fight with him all the time and you're going to ask for forgiveness, at least you can go. You know, when the doctor said you got 3 months to live, that's a good thing. You got 3 months to fix things. Well, everybody, the whole world blasted that doctor in England. One of the universities in England come with that thing and say that the only disease you can praise God for that is cancer. Who's going to pray the Lord for cancer? You know how many people die every year for cancer? Are you kidding me? But I understand the point. And obviously, when somebody say you get cancer, it's like the seal of death in your forehead. And you know that. We lose a lot of here in this church, Dick Hansen, that we're still missing him. Right? So you see the battle that he got with Phyllis' brother, I forget his name, Jim, and some others here in church, cancer. Oh, Edith, you remember Edith? Margie. Lord, have mercy on us. You see, cancer is something bad. But, you know, like I said, nobody liked that trip, the trip to death. Well, I want to invite you guys to open your Bibles, and I'm just going to give you a glance of this in chapter 13 of the Gospel of John. Jesus, knowing what is coming, that trip without return, with no return, that he's going to make. He invites the disciples to a dinner, for a meal, evening meal. Verse 2 in chapter 13 say the evening meal was in progress, and the devil has already prompted Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot, to betray Jesus. Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power, and that he had come from God and was returning to God. So he got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing, and wrapped in towel around his waist. And you know the rest. What had he done at that moment? He stand up, take the feet of the disciples, and start washing. So you imagine in those times, they don't have a nice shoes like Nike and all these brands that we have now, Adidas and all these brands. No, sandals, handmade, you know, a lot of dirt, no pavement, road, no concrete, nothing. So you imagine what kind of feet Jesus washed. Okay, get out of that picture now a little bit and imagine Jesus is the King of Kings. The God of God, Jesus, the Almighty God, the Creator, now washing dirty feet. You ever think about that? That's your Savior. That's my Savior. That's the one who died on a cross for you and me. Why he do that? Did he need to do that? Did Jesus need to wash the feet of dirty feet of his disciples? No, he doesn't. But he do us example, humility, humbleness. The Almighty God, who thousands and billions and millions of angels praising his name, now humanize, take the flesh, and go that low because he loved you so much. That is the reason. It's because of love. And he wanted to teach Judas Iscariot a lesson. He's the best teacher, right, Valencia? She teach about the best teacher on the planet Earth, the lesson of this week. What did he teach Jesus with that? Get in his knee and washing the dirty feet of his disciples? Are you kidding me? Why did he need to do that? The King of Kings, when everybody's praising his name. Do you imagine when the crowd approaching Jesus and the Garden of Gethsemane to arrest Jesus? Ellen G. White described in a book of Desire of Ages, the almighty angels, it was waiting a order from the Father to rescue his general, Jesus Christ. and helping him and destroy that crowd. Just one angel, it can destroy everyone in seconds. And they waiting and waiting, and nothing happened. He has to pass that test. He has to pass all that shame for you and me. But not only that. So those almighty angels watching Jesus do all these things, washing dirty feet of his disciples. So he went on, and that Peter refused. No, Lord, don't do that to me. I'm not going to let. Jesus said, well, if you don't let me do this, you're not going to be part of me in heaven. And then Peter go, no, if that's the reason, watch me completely. You can read the rest in there. And then he announced who's going to betray him, right in the table. They ask who's going to be. They look at each other. But Judas know that was his role. But also he predict Peter's denial 3 times. All this is going on. So he's like preparing them. I'm leaving, guys. 3.5 years I spent with you. Now I'm leaving. But I will come back, he say. And they get disturbed. Do you imagine like a children's when the mother leave? Those children, I imagine when you leave or you disappear from the house for a little bit and the kids looking at you everywhere, Mom, where are you? That's kids, right? Normal. When you grow up, well, you can handle that situation, but when you're a child, you're afraid of everything. If a tree is moving, you think it's a ghost or something, you know? So based on all that, so Jesus is leaving, like I said, when you leave, when no return, it's buried, what they call farewell. Normally we do for the loved one who died. And we do a memorial. And we remember all the good things or bad things, whatever that person did. Never remember the bad things, all the good things when you die. I don't know why. Do you realize that? People remember all the good things that you did, but now nobody remembers the bad thing. That's a good thing, I guess. Unless someone probably in the corner over there says, oh, I'm glad he's dead. Or she's dead. Whatever. I don't know if those people happen. But, some point or moment in life, they show up. But anyway, we go back to chapter 14 when Jesus give all these gloomy, dark evening that he passed with disciples, denial, predicting this, predicting that, preparing them. It's like I said, well, if you have a cancer and the doctor give you 3 months, 90 days to live, what are you going to tell your kids? Come on, kids, everyone, let me tell you what I think or what I'm going to leave it to you or not. And you know any night or any day you're going to die. Well, Jesus is preparing disciples for this event. And look at what happened in verse 1 in chapter 14. Do not let your heart be troubled. Do you believe in God? Believe also in me, he said. You believe in God? Okay, that God is my Father. You got to believe in me too, he said. My Father has many rooms, but I like another version, say many mansions. Do you ever think about a mansion in your life? What is a mansion? What is it? What is a mansion for you? A big house with empty walls? Huh? A lot of room, but what is a mansion? What exactly does it mean? I have a furniture or just the walls? So you go to that kitchen, to that mansion, what does that kitchen have? Imagine the kitchen. Imagine the kitchen. Ladies, come on. You like kitchens, right? Oh, guys, I like to cook. I like cook, too. Yeah. What about if you go to this sunroom and they have a big jacuzzi in there and you're walking and there's silver, gold everywhere? nice marble walls, high ceiling, not shorty one, 7 foot that you barely fit in there. Mansion is a mansion. And I like that language because I check in different, in my phone, different versions. This version that I have is a room. But it's kind of narrow. Our mind, you go, oh, okay, it's a room. So in other words, Jesus is going to put me in a room in heaven? No, no. I like more the concept of a mansion. I want a mansion. I want it for myself. How many square foot is enough for you? If you understand the language of footage. How much square footage is good for you? Because my real estate agent, she lives in a Blue Ridge area, and we're talking all the time because of the negotiation with the houses and all that stuff. And she say, I have a little house in a Blue Ridge area, and it's 800 square foot. But she lives by herself. And I said, Lisa, come on, 800? Well, I realized 800 square foot is a lot of space. I mean, for one person. But when you think about a mansion, it's no limit. That's what I ask you. What is a mansion for you? What do you portray in your head when you're thinking about a mansion? What is it? Valencia, what is a mansion for you? What do you describe as a mansion? Big land, big property? Praise the Lord. So you want the maid too. Okay. Okay. All right. All right. But do you see, if you think out of the box, now, I don't know where you guys live. Someone might know, someone not. Most of you, I don't know. 99% of you, I don't know where you guys live and how you live. Someone, you let me get to your house, someone not. So, but anyway, I don't want to judge that. It's not my intention or purpose. But what I'm saying is, whatever you leave, you appreciate because, and you praise the Lord for that roof that you have, right? But imagine Jesus going to heaven to prepare a mansion for you, for yourself. So if you're sharing a room now, Bush, you're going to have your own room, and Barbara is going to have her. So that is no more fighting in there. You already have. Okay. All right. So, you know, I like that when Jesus say, my Father have many rooms, many mansions. If that were not so, he say, well, I have told you that I'm going in there, but right? To prepare a place for you. Are you kidding me? Do you imagine all the distress or betrayal and nightmare that night, Jesus washing feet, dirty feet for his disciples? And then he know Judas Iscariot after that dinner, he left out because they paid 30 coins to betray him. And all that gloomy night was not pleasant. Jesus come with this because Jesus have the solution for everything in your life. Doesn't matter how bad that night, that stormy night, I was asleep and my wife doesn't have a night, a good night, and the dog. Both of them, they wake me up. I was passed out. I was so exhausted for the past 3 nights, packaging, you know, dealing with everything. So it was a nightmare for me all that week, almost the week. But I fall in the bed and I don't know nothing. But for them, when they hear the noise of the winds and third, you know, like when Elijah was running from Ahab and that evil queen, but you know, with the Lord approaching him. So he say, verse 3, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back. Praise the Lord for that. He promised he's leaving them, he's leaving us, but he will come back. And then he say, I will come back and take you. Take you, Bush. Take you, Ball. Take you, Ron. Thank you, Sherwin. That's what Jesus said. You take personal that. Take personal. I don't mind. I can take personal. I will come back, Jesus say, and take you to be with me. that you all also may be where I am. Do you imagine this? Do you imagine that picture when everybody have a different concerns and after that dinner was suspense, thinking who's going to be betrayed? Our master, the disciples probably, they look at each other. Peter said, oh, no, I'm never going to deny you, Lord. I'm going to fight. I'm going to go to death for you. And Jesus said, bite your tongue, Peter. You will fail, but I will help you. Judas Iscariot was a totally different thing. He don't wait for the mercy of the Lord. He went with the devil. But you know, verse 4 said, you know the way. Look at this. You know the way to the place where I'm going. Wait a minute. Do you think the disciples know the way where Jesus is going? Thomas say, verse 5. This is Thomas, the guy who don't trust anything. Sometimes we acting like him. I'm one of those. I'm screwing a lot of things. To believe something, that's the guy who say, I don't stick my finger in the one I don't believe is him. This is Thomas. Thomas say to him, Lord, we don't know where you're going. So how can we know the way? Because Jesus said, you know the way where I'm going. And Thomas said, Lord, I don't know. We don't know, he said, as a group. He speak as a group. We don't know the way where you're going. And then Jesus answered, I am the way. Praise the Lord for that. That lift me up. He said, I am the way, Thomas. I am the way and the true and the life. Three things. What do you want in life? The right way, right? The true and life. Nobody want to die. What is life? Jesus give life. Jesus is the true. He is the way. How many people you see now lost in their anxious world? They want to fix everything, but they can't. Politicians, now we're in a political environment now because everybody promised a bunch of things. Do you think they're the right way? No. Politicians, they lie all the time. They promise things, and they never accomplish anything. But Jesus, when Jesus say, I am the way and the truth and life, those three things, that's what we need from him, right? So, no one come to the Father except through me, he say. If you really know me, you will know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. Okay, so he answered very wildly that the question that Thomas made. But then the other disciple, pop, out of the blue, he come. Philip say, Lord, show us the Father. Well, he's talking about the Father. Do you know the Father? Because you know me. And Philip say, wait a minute. We don't see the Father, Lord. And look at what Philip say. Philip was another crazy guy making crazy questions. So look at what happened in that question the Philip made. He say, Lord, show us the Father, and that will enough for us. Oh, okay, Jesus answered. Don't you know me, Philip? I guess Jesus was kind of standing in front of Philip, say, okay, Philip, you don't know me? Even after I have been among you such a long time, anyone who has seen me, Jesus say, is see the Father. Let me tell you something. In one of my devotionals, one of these days, last week I think it was, is made by Ellen G. White. And she described the first couple in the Garden of Eden after the sin. they never see the God again, face to face. And she said, one of the things that she highlighted, Ellen G. White highlighted, is she said, that is the reason the Father sent Jesus, so the humans, we can see him through Jesus. Do you get the point now? So nobody can see the Father. That relationship that our forefather has in the past, Adam and Eve, nobody can see the Father anymore. But we see his face. We see his will. We see everything. We feel him because of Jesus Christ. How many of you feel that Jesus is in your life all the time? And he is in your side when you cry? What about when you're happy? That he's there too? Of course. So that's exactly what happened. Ellen G. White said that God and his mercy say, well, I will provide my son so they can see me through him. And that's exactly what Jesus told Phillips in here. You guys spent 3.5 years with me here, and you don't know the Father? I am the Father. I'm the everything, he say. And, you know, it's so interesting the way Jesus put that to Phillips, because he answered to us now. So if we see Jesus, we see the Father. So now I'm going to ask you, how many of you see our Heavenly Father? How many? No one? I do, because I've seen Jesus. If you see Jesus, you feel Jesus in your heart. It's the Father. It's there. It's so, you know, interesting the way Jesus portrayed himself. I'm the Father. You know, I'm the founder of this whole universe. But the answer, he said, anyone who see me has seen the Father. Jesus said, how you can say, show us the Father? So Jesus gave the answer and then generate another question for them. Don't you believe that I am in the Father? Right? And that the Father is in me? You see the question Jesus made. The word I say to you, I do not speak on my own authority. Rather, is the Father live in me who is doing this work. All the miracles do you see? Everything I do? All those people that I resurrect from the tomb? I did because the Father is in me. Believe in me when I say that I am the Father and the Father is in me. Or at least believe on the evidence of the word themselves. Very truly, I told you, whoever believes in me will do the work. In other words, if we believe in Jesus, we do the work he does. Whatever he done before, I have been doing, right? So whatever you believe in him, you got to do the work that he done because you are part of him. And they will do even greater things than this, he say, because I am going to the Father, Jesus say, verse 13, and say, and I will do whatever you ask in my name so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. Jesus say, I will answer you only a few things. That's what he say? What did he say? Whatever you ask in my name, what's going to happen? He will provide, because the Father is responding to our prayers through Jesus. You may ask me for anything in my name, and I will do it. Praise the Lord for that. Anything you ask, he say anything. Doesn't say just some things. So I can say to you this morning, it doesn't matter what worries you have. I read in 1934, or in the 30s, early 30s, mid-30s, President Roosevelt created what they call now Social Security Administration. And the concern was the people retired with no funds. And typical politicians, they, like always, they say, we're going to help you. So now, you know, we pay Social Security. They force you. It's not voluntary. They deduct it from your check. Right? And then when you go back, but one of the things that I find out with the Social Security thing was interesting, the life expectancy in those years, it was between 60 to 65, if you're lucky. Well, guess what? They put the retirement age at 65. Excuse me? If you retire at 65 and the life expectancy in those times was 65, the plan was that you're going to pay all the money and you're not going to get nothing back. Right? So that's typical politician lie. But anyway, it's funny, but all the American people see that was great and they support the idea. The Congress, Senate passed, blah, blah, blah. He signed the law. And now we have the Social Security thing. But why the government create that? It was to assure the American people you're going to be well taken care of when you get old. Right? Now you can see each other, the politicians, they fighting each other about that. And we fighting with the administration, the Social Security Administration, to collect the same money they already deduct from you. I remember one radio host years ago, he do us a joke, but it was true. He say, if you call the Social Security office and you say, I'm a Nelson Perlo, my Social Security number is this, is that, I want to know how much money I got in that in my account. And they're going to say, what? What account? You don't have an account in here. I said, well, that makes sense. So you can give your Social Security number. It doesn't mean they're going to tell you how much you put it in there. Nah. They control the money. So, but anyway, the concept, the assurance, the concept of that you're going to be well taken care of when you get old, it was great. So they create Social Security for that reason, and a lot of people enjoy it. I'm not against that. I just say how politicians play with that and with us sometimes when, you know, when they need it. But my point is, everybody wants to be secure. You see, everybody wants to have a secure job and get paid really good and a bunch of benefits. This is the early stuff, right? This is what the world offers. But what about all these things that Jesus promised to us and his disciples? I go into my Father's house. And I know that house is so big, it have a lot of mansions. And I said to myself, how big our Heavenly Father house is that Jesus offered to every one of us a mansion? How big that house is? Do you ever think about it? Do you imagine what kind of food you're going to eat in there? And that mansion provide by the Heavenly Father. You imagine the chef who's cooking in there? Do you know that dinner when Jesus promised disciples, I will do this again. I will eat this bread and I will drink this wine with you next time when we get together in heaven again. You want to be part of that? You want to be part of that dinner? Do you imagine what kind of food is going to be on that table? Do you ever think about it? Do you ever think of how you're going to dress? What kind of clothes you're going to wear in that dinner? Do you imagine that table, how long it's going to be? Well, all these redeemers, you're going to see Adam and Eve in there. You're going to see Abraham, Moses. You can see beside Daniel if you want. And you ask, what happened in the lion's den? I mean, it's okay. You can ask. Do you ever think about it? Let me tell you something. Sometimes when I read this thing and I think back, let my mind fly. But Apostle Paul say, it's nothing what we think compared to what is coming and what God offered to us. So this planet Earth, if we have a mansion here, I just moved to another house. My wife like, I kind of, that's okay. She's happy, I'm happy. but you know, what I'm saying is, whatever we have in here on the planet Earth, what kind of car you drive, good or bad, whatever, I don't know, or what kind of house you have, or apartment, or room, whatever you live, it's temporarily. It's temporarily. But if you believe in Jesus Christ, that's what he said, if you believe in me, I will come back, and I will take you with me so you can spend the eternity with me in that mansion. So if you feel that you want to go there and thinking about it, you want to bring your family with you? Yes. Me too. And I pray every day for my kids and those family members that I know they're not here or they're not in church this Sabbath. They're doing their own thing. And that worries me. But guess what? How many friends you have? Good friends. They're not churchgoers. They don't come to church, but they're good people. Do you want to see them in there too? In that long table? You see what kind, when you get a grape, you're not going to go like that, you know? You're going to get the two hands and get that grape and bite like that, probably because those grapes, they're going to be big. They're not going to get small. From California, Chile, they come from Peru or Chile. Those grapes that we eat, now is the time of grape. I love it because they're so sweet. But you imagine that table, what kind of fruits you're going to have? And the bread. Do you like bread? Oh, do you imagine what kind of bread is going to be on the table in heaven? You don't have to worry about the calories or the carbs. You know, I go so deep when I'm thinking about this, what Jesus offered to us and what this planet Earth offering to us. But you know what? We're so tight in here. And we concern so much about the daily things, what's going on in the weekly things, if we pay our bills, if we pay your phone, if I don't pay, they're going to cut off, how am I going to call my kids, how are they going to call me? You know, all these worries. Disease, pain, jail, you know, a lot of people in prison, they get in prison for whatever the reasons are. All this nonsense that the devil generates in our lives and worries, it will disappear eventually. Praise the Lord for that. It will disappear. And let me tell you something. When you're really into Jesus, you're not even afraid of death. Do you know that? Because Apostle Paul said that if you die, it's gaining. Why? Because the devil, it can touch you no more. You seal in a tomb for Jesus Christ and the final trumpet, you stand up and say praise the Lord because Jesus sleep. You know, you're in a sleeping process. So the devil, when you sleep, you can commit a sin. Right? When you die. If you seal with Jesus, you seal it. He can touch you. No way. But if you're alive, the devil, he can touch you. He can put a temptation and he make you fail and the whole thing. So when you really in Jesus, it's not that you ask for dying, right? It's not the point. Because when you're alive, you want to spread the good news of the gospel to others and tell how good God is with us. But, you know, I'd like to invite everyone this morning, if you feel, do you have issues in your life that nobody knows, but you have it? Bad habit, bad behavior, I don't know, whatever, a disease, you have a problem with your family, concerns, worries, that sometimes it makes you sad and loneliness. Because we see people and we don't know what the terrible life they live internally and inside of them. Sometimes they smile, sometimes not. Sometimes they laugh. We don't know. The only thing we know is that Jesus is there with you, no matter how lonely you are, no matter what kind of trouble you have, no matter what kind of disease they detected on you, Jesus is there to be with you and make you happy. Because whoever is with Jesus is happy. You know why? Because you feel salvation start here on the planet Earth. Salvation is not in the future. Salvation started here. As soon as you accept Jesus as your Savior, salvation starts here. That's the way the Bible portrays that. So if anyone feels that you think you want to be part of that big dinner with Jesus in heaven, and you want to be part of the promise, a return of Jesus to pick you up, and you want to be prepared to wait for him, stand up. If you feel that way, stand up. And we're going to pray to prepare us for that big day with the final trumpet. And thousands of angels come with Jesus. If you're dead, your tomb will be open. If you're alive, you will be transformed from this ugly flesh to a radiant body, a celestial body with no sin. You're going to be transformed a totally different person. You're going to be a heavenly person. And I'm sure we're going to open our heart this morning to wait for that second coming of Jesus, because he promising his word. We're going to pray for it. Heavenly Father, again, Lord, thank you for your word. Thank you for the hope. Thank you for that relief that we have on you, that you promise us to be with us all the time. Thank you, Lord, for every brother and sister this morning here. And we like to prepare, Lord, our lives, everything on us, to waiting for that second return of you. We like to enjoy what you thus mentioned, that you prepare. And you, our Father, prepare for us to enjoy with you for the eternity, Lord. This planet Earth doesn't deserve our lives in here. But we're here, Lord. We're still here. And we love our family members, our friends around us. Use us as a tools to help them to come to you, to speak up about the good news, good tidings of the gospel. Thank you, Lord, for letting us to be part of you and part of the heavenly family. We not belong in this planet Earth. We belong to be with you. Please help us, Lord, and give us the chance. We have trials. We have issues in our lives. We have temptation that we fail sometimes. Please help us to be victorious. A victors on you, Lord. Give us the power to defeat the enemy in the name of Jesus and the Holy Spirit. Bless everyone. And now that we're leaving, please take care of us for the rest of the week. And let us be with you and communicate with you via prayer all the time. Thank you, Lord, for everything and for your word and your encouragement. In Jesus we ask. Amen.